Well, thank you very much, Excellency. Thank you. You raised a number of questions which are very important, and I think much in the spirit of this World Policy Conference, the naming, namely to promote dialogue, negotiations, diplomacy, etc., etc. So these are very important points, and now I invite those who would like to intervene to do so, and I will start with our friend Jim Hoagland from the Washington Post, and then Renaud Girard, whom I see from Le Figaro.
Mr. Minister, you've very eloquently outlined the impasse that's developed, the stalemate between you and Saudi Arabia on the one side. The United States has very strong military relationship with Qatar, but has taken a position of neutrality in this conflict. At what point will that begin to affect, that American position, begin to affect the military relationship between Qatar and the United States?
Well, Qatar and the United States has enjoyed and still enjoying very good and strong relationship when it comes especially to the military relationship, but also in other areas, in economy and investment, education. The strong military relationship between Qatar and the United States has been affected not in terms of the strength of this relationship, but really the global efforts to fight terrorism has been affected by this crisis. When we are hosting around 11,000 US troops in Qatar, and we have the center of command for the global coalition, and this country is under blockade, of course it's affected. When we have our soldiers fighting with from the bases of some of the blockading countries and they've been expelled, there is a direct impact on the global efforts in countering terrorism and countering Daesh, namely here. There is an impact even on our joint training, when everybody has noticed that the Defense Department has suspended any joint training between the Gulf countries until this crisis resolved. There is a series of things which has been, which represented a great impact on this security relationship, not on Qatar-US only, but it's on US-GCC relationship and on US policy toward the Middle East and toward countering terrorism. Regarding the neutrality of the U.S. position, U.S. has been very consistent from the beginning and very clear in their position. They want this crisis to be resolved. Yes, we were the country, and we are the country which is subject to this aggression from those four countries, and we expected more of allies and more of friends to stand with us and to show that they are rejecting the violations of the international law, that they are rejecting the humanitarian impact from this crisis. U.S. has been one of the frontier in this, and they have rejected the blockade. They have rejected that this crisis continue, and they are trying to call for dialogue. But when you have any conflict or any crisis, there are always two parties of the crisis. If one of the parties are still unwilling to engage and to talk, you cannot put an end for this. Even if he will come by force to the dialogue table, he will never come with a good faith or with the intention to solve the problem. Qatar will remain in its position. Have the best way forward for us is the dialogue, and we will, whenever they decide that they want to solve this crisis, Qatar will be there on the table waiting for them with our friends and our allies, whether it's in the United States or in the other friendly countries.
Renaud Girard.
Good morning, Minister. I'm Renaud Girard, Figaro Foreign Affairs columnist. The Turkish government has sent military troops to secure your country. What is the strength of this military alliance with Turkey? How do you see the future of the relationship between Turkey and Qatar? And second question, there is a much closer country to you, which is Iran. I mean, closer geographically, of course. And they helped you also with food and humanitarian aid. How do you assess your future relations with Iran? And how do you assess the stability of the Gulf in the future with Iran on one side and Sunni monarchies on the other side of the Gulf? Thank you.
Thank you, sir. First, just regarding your question about the Turkish forces. First of all, Qatar and Turkey has very strong and strategic relationship. In the same way, in defense and in economy, we have very strong investment ties and bilateral trade ties as well. And Turkey is an important regional country. It's an important country in the region. It is a NATO member, which we have a relation with other member states as well. We have the largest presence of troops is the U.S. presence. And we have also a different defense cooperation agreement with other countries like France, United Kingdom, and Turkey is one among them. Having them and having some of their troops in Doha, yes, it helps in the security of the country, but it's also in the context of a wider range of cooperation between our both countries, where we have also a representation from our military there in Angerlik base. We have our cooperation is governed by this agreement also in the global, within the global coalition, countering Daesh coalition. So Turkey will remain an important regional player, yes, will remain a strong partner and strong ally for Qatar, but doesn't contradict with any of our partnerships or any with any of our of the other alliances we have. And once you surrender your sovereignty to give up on the relation, on a military relation with Turkey, it will be just a starting point, and then we will be asked, we might be asked in one day that we also kick the US troops outside Qatar, or we end our defense cooperation with France, or we do the same with UK, or to do this and not to do that. This is something which is unacceptable for any sovereign nation to impose and to dictate something. As we say that if this was reflected on their demands because of some of the security concerns, first of all, they need to understand that the demands cannot be imposed on a sovereign state. If there is any conflict or any difference, there should be a dialogue and engagement and understanding, and not a demand from a country toward another. So if they have any security concerns, we are willing to sit and to engage in a dialogue to address those concerns, because their security concern will be our security concern. We are from the same region, and there is a common threat we will be exposed to if they are going to be exposed to any threat. Regarding the future of our relationship with Iran, our relationship with Iran has been consistent since years. We didn't change our policy, although we have now different situation and different circumstances when Qatar is blocked from three sides, and I have just one way toward the north to fly or to send my shipments. which needs from me to intensify my communication with them. But at the end, the differences in policies between Qatar and Iran will remain there, because the policy is normally based on principles, based on assessments. So those differences, how should we overcome? Is it by confrontation? It will not work, and it will never work. And this is what we have been calling for since 2015. The irony here that in 2015, when the JCPOA being signed, President Obama has called all the member states in the GCC to Camp David to discuss and to address their security concern with Iran. And he was encouraging the Gulf state to engage in dialogue with Iran. And when President Rouhani has sent he expressed his willingness for dialogue to the Emir of Kuwait, all of the Gulf leaders agreed to engage in dialogue, which is based on principles. And this agreement remained until 2016, until the end of 2016. Now, when the same countries being invited by the President of the United States to engage in a dialogue about Qatar, no one has responded to this positively, or no one has expressed his willingness to engage in such a dialogue. In summary, our relation with Iran will remain the same. The differences will be there until we overcome these differences by addressing those security concerns we have together. But we cannot afford a further escalation not between Qatar and Iran only, but between any country in the region and Iran. We believe in dialogue, we believe in engagement. Iran is a neighboring country for us. We share borders, we share a gas field together. We have more things between us we need to address by dialogue, and we cannot address by just escalating against each other or avoiding talking to each other. Because if we are going to remain avoiding talking to each other, the problem will remain there, and it will never reach an end. And sometimes it might reach to a level which will create another crisis which the region cannot afford.
I can take one last question. No? No. Yes. No. One, sorry. The Patriarch? No. Who? So I have the choice. Okay, so between Germany and Israel, I choose Israel. Okay, Ambassador Rabinovich.
Sorry for Germany. Mr. Minister, Qatar has been a supporter of Hamas in the Gaza Strip. More recently, Hamas has drawn close to Egypt, and the reconciliation between Hamas and the Palestinian Authority is considered by many to have been inspired to a great extent by Egypt. Does that mean a distancing between yourselves and Hamas?
Well, first, just let me make it very clear here. Qatar never support Hamas. Qatar always support the people of Gaza and supported the reconstruction effort of Gaza Strip. Hamas is a party which has a position there in Gaza, yes, but the support has been always very transparent and visible for everyone, including your government. They know very well where the money goes, and they know the contribution of this support to the peace and stability of the Strip of Gaza, which prevent the Strip of Gaza from any potential war. And here we have used the principle in our policy in supporting the people and supporting the reconstruction and the resilience of the community as a mean of peace, as a mean of stability. And we have witnessed this stability now since the 2014. Hamas' relation with Qatar is a political representation where they have their office there, which has been very useful for everyone. When they were in Qatar, they've been Qatar was a facilitator for different engagements, whether to end the two wars in Gaza in 2008, 2009, and 2014, has been a facilitator for the reconciliation, the national reconciliation, which is the first step for any peace deal between the Palestinian and the Israeli. Now, with Hamas relation with Egypt and Egypt contribution in the reconciliation, Qatar was the first country welcomed this reconciliation between Hamas and the Palestinian Authority, because we believe in the unity of the Palestinian as a precondition for any peace deal. Whoever is brokering this deal, Qatar will be helpful and will be welcoming. Qatar has take now the funding of the construction, the reconstruction of the government facility there in Gaza, because we believe in the unity of the Palestinian, because Hamas today is in Egypt. I think the question need to be asked for the countries whom are using this narrative in the United States or with the Western audience, that it is the reason for them to blockade my country. Their reason and their claims now that Qatar is supporting Hamas, why they never disconnected themselves with Hamas, or they never considered Hamas as a terrorist organization. Just now, they start to talk about it, and suddenly we find Hamas in Egypt being praised by the Egyptian government and by the other government. So, Qatar position has been very clear and has been very transparent and very visible to everyone. We will continue supporting the people there in Gaza because they are people who are in need. And we believe that our support and our contribution in Gaza has contributed to the peace and the stability of the region. And we will be the first to celebrate any national unity between the Palestinians themselves.
Well, thank you very much, Minister. I think it was a very interesting and useful conversation. So thank you very much again.